what are the expectations that you have from the session? Just some brief. Anyone? I mean, you can even speak up if you want. You don't need to write in the chat. You can speak up.
Hello.
Hello.
Hi guys, Suyash here.
Hey Dipanshu, Ankur this way.
Yeah, Ankur.
Yeah, basically from this session, I would like to like figure, learn more about like how to go about designing basically integrated circuits, like how to go about figuring out the architecture and basically designing them, like how to start off with that.
Okay, okay, okay. Which year are you in?
Actually, I'm from a mechanical background,
okay.
And I'm like third year of mechanical, but like I'm quite into electronics as well.
Okay, 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 okay. Okay. We'll see to this. All options. Okay. We'll be saying what are options we can have in case of PLS and where and how to get about it. Okay, great. Others. See, this is not a session where we'll just speak and you will just listen to us. It should be interactive. Otherwise, it will become very boring. Trust me. And the speakers over here today, Suyash, me and Sulta, we are not like professional speakers or something. We are just here to share our knowledge, what we have learned from 4 years of college and a few months in industry. So please just make it interactive, please.
Okay, so have we all gotten our introduction? Right up. Okay.
Anyone else would like to just pitch in? Just let me know if my screen is visible to you. Maybe just a yes or no from someone. Speak up, please. Yes, okay. Okay. Okay, so first of all, I'll just give you a brief introduction about me and my colleagues. Okay, so my name is Dipanshu Gupta. I am working in Bosch, and to be very particular, I am working in Robert Bosch Engineering and Business Solutions, India. So RBEI, which we call it, it is a subsidiary of Bosch. So I work for that. I work as an associate software engineer, and specifically speaking, I work in the exhaust department. So you have your exhaust systems in your cars. So basically, whatever designing goes into that, like how to reduce the emissions and all. So whatever components are there in the exhaust system, we control them and how we should reduce the emissions. So basically, that is where I work on. And Sumita, if you could just give us a short introduction about it.
Hello everyone. This is Sumita. I'm currently working as analog circuit design engineer in Indraprastha, Hyderabad. So my job basically involves designing circuits which process analog signals from transistor level. So you guys must have heard of ADC. Okay, first let me ask you one question. How many of you are from first year? Please answer. No one is from first year.
Anyone from first year can just tap in the chat that they are from first year, so that we can just keep a count. Yes.
Sorry, Suresh, can you please
repeat? I'm just asking all the people from first year and second year should like tell their respective years in the chat so that we can modulate the content according to them.
Yeah.
Otherwise, it will just be for fourth year people or it will just be for third year people. We have to intermediate that, and for that we need to know like which year you're from.
The second year, first year. Okay. So majorly we have people from first year and second year.
I guess so. Mostly from second year.
Yeah, first year, second year mix.
So, so you second year guys, especially second year, so you guys must be knowing about analog to digital converter or digital to analog converter, or the pins, the GPIO pins, and the PLL phase lock loop. So I designed those things from circuit level, or to simplify even more, I designed amplifiers, or you guys know operational amplifiers. So I design these things from circuit level. So that's all about my job.
Okay, so Dibanshan and Sumita have given their introductions. I am Suyash and I'm currently working as a DFT engineer at Infochips. Well, DFT is not as simple as embedded and what you can say analog, it's not quite heard of. But to give a brief description, DFT is a part of VLSI flow. So at a major abstraction level, you can say I work as in VLSI. But if you go into depth, which I'll probably be able to explain during the course of this session, what DFT is and what my work is. So primarily I work as a DFT engineer. DFT stands for design for testability. And saying about that, DFT, that is, what you can say, job of a DFT engineer basically to ensure that several required architectures and design components are inserted in your chips so that their testing can be done at the tester after manufacturing, and so that we can get an exact exact mapping of where the error in that chip is. Okay, so that is briefly what my job is. I think we can continue with the presentation now.
This is about our introduction. Okay, and okay, Suresh.
Yes, the question.
Yeah, just take over from there.
Okay, so I'll have to take over from there. Wait, so do I need to share my screen or you will be sharing with us?
No, I'm sharing my screen.
Okay, so let's begin with VLSI. Okay, since the main heading of this whole, webinar and the poster was opportunities in VLSI and embedded. So I'm pretty sure most of you have familiarity with what embedded systems is, but I'm also pretty sure that some of you, in fact, most of you, since you're in first and second year, have little to very less clue about what VLSI is. Okay, so how many people here know what VLSI is? If anyone knows, just type plus one in chat, or you can just turn on your mic and speak up.
Guys, please feel free to speak up. I mean, you can just unmute your mic and just speak up. That would be a better. That will be better for us. I mean, we could understand. Okay, we are not just talking to a screen; we are actually talking to people.
Okay. Kamil Mani says he knows only abbreviation.
Abbreviation.
Ankur,
okay.
Ankur and Rahul say they know about VLSI plus one. Okay. Which year you are from, guys?
I am from third year. Ankur is saying.
Okay, Ankur is from third year. Okay, so you must be having your subject to VLSI. Rahul is from second year. Okay.
Ankur, you are mechanical, right?
Yeah, I'm from mechanical, but like I know about embedded circuits, but what I want to learn more about is how VLSI circuits are designed on the silicon, on the transistor level.
Okay.
Okay. Amil Mani is from second year. Okay. Let's start with what VLSI is. So basically, VLSI stands for, as you can see in the presentation, stands for very large scale integration. Okay, it's sort of an abbreviation, but to look at the greater aspect, VLSI is basically the branch of electronics that deals with designing and implementation of integrated circuits. Okay, so what do you mean by integrated circuits? It's an IC. Okay, and where do you see these ICs? The first and foremost example is in your labs. If you are an EC or AAA student, you must have seen these ICs in your electronics lab. If you are not a AAA or EE student, AAA or EC student, you could also have seen them in your labs in first year, okay? In those electrical labs. I'm not sure if they make you work with them, but yeah. So we have these ICs. Now, ICs that you see in lab are quite small and what you can say, less complicated. Those are AND gates, okay, NAND gates, basic 8 pin to 10 pins ICs. What VLSI majorly comprises of these days is SoC designing. SoC is system on chip. Those ICs are the ICs that are major that majorly constitute the processors and your motherboards and all those computation automation systems that you use. Okay, so they're not 8 to 10 pins, they're basically in hundreds and thousands of pins. That is the what you can say. I'll describe that. That's the scale of the designs that you work on. Okay, so that is basically VLSI. So I think Ankur asked this question that he wants to know about how to go with IC designing. So yes, VLSI is definitely the field if you want to pursue IC designing or anything remotely related to that. Okay. So here we have various levels of designs are numbered and the block show processes in the design flow. Okay, Devanshu, can you move it to the next slide? There will be a flow diagram.
Can you see?
I cannot actually. Next slide. There will be yes. Okay, I can see now. All of you guys can see, I believe. Okay. So this is basically all in all the flow of a VLSI IC designing process. Okay, to compile it in brief, I'd say it begins with specifications. Okay, the consumer or the company who wants their IC design, first of all, they'll have to give some specifications to the designer or to the company who's manufacturing those ICs about the frequencies, the area, the power requirements. Okay, like there are okay, so to give you an example, suppose you are going to buy a laptop. Okay, so you'll definitely check out the specs. More often, most people will check out the specs. Depends on you, what are your requirements. You look for either an i3 processor or an i5 processor or an i7 processor or an AMD processor. Depending on if you need a graphic processor, you will look for a graphic card or you won't look for a graphic card. So those are the specifications. Okay. Similarly, when any company or an individual, whoever is having their project manufactured, whenever that person needs their IC design, first process is just having the specifications out, given to the designer, telling them how much clock frequency do they want. See, you see i3 works at 2.2 gigahertz. i7 works at 2.8 gigahertz. So those are different clock frequencies. Okay, so the designer needs to be told which clock frequency does he need to design the design for. Okay, so first process is that you give the clock frequencies, the what you can say, area requirements, how big should be the chip, size of the chip, how many pins there can be on the chips. Okay, and what power does it work on, 3 volt, 5 volt, 3.3 volt. Okay, lower or higher than that, anything like that. Then the next step after designing is your after specifications is your designing, where the person basically puts the IC. Okay. Now this will be a very new concept to most of you who are from first year or second year. Until now, all that you have been familiar to is that you do programming on software that is run on hardware. Okay. Have not the concept of writing a program that makes a hardware. Okay, so here comes the concept of hardware description languages. Those are called HDL languages. You must have heard of Verilog, VHDL, system Verilog, and all that. If you haven't heard, no big deal. These are probably covered up in third year or fourth year in our colleges. So yeah, these are the languages that are quite similar to C++, more like in the syntax basis, but work at a very different level. Okay, these languages are then used to design the code, like to code the design. Okay, you write the code for the design, and then please feel free to okay. Yeah. After you write the code of whatever IC you're trying to make, that code is then verified. Okay, simulated, waveform is checked after simulation, and then you verify that code. There are different steps in verification and different profiles in verification. We'll cover that too. Okay, so we have that. That design is first coded. Hardware description languages.
Okay,
yes. Okay. So, if I do share my screen, I can just like write on notepad and you guys can see that whatever I'm writing and what are the use for. Okay, I will cover that. Nice. Okay, Ankur. Dipanshu, can let me share my screen?
Yeah, sure.
Okay. So yeah. You guys can see, right? I can't. Okay. Yes. Ankur. Okay. So we have HDL languages. What HDL stands for is hardware description languages. Okay. What are they used for? They are used for coding the hardware IC. We'll cover that in detail. Okay. Example. All these languages. Okay. So this is your first step. Let me just go. Okay, this is the first step. Let me just ask a question. How many of you here know about digital electronics? How many of you here are familiar with the concept of AND gates, OR gates, multiplexers, okay, flip-flops? Dipanshu, I can't exactly see the chat screen, so okay. Please just keep a count of how many people are saying.
We have
okay, Saurav Jha is saying he knows a little bit. So okay.
Ravi, Harsh, Rajvi,
okay.
Yeah. So we have some. Okay. 6 to 7 people have replied.
Okay. So most of you should be familiar with these logic gates because you have studied them in physics class 12. Okay, by the end of class 12, you had a chapter where you covered logic gates like, yeah, Boolean algebra and those chapters you had, right? As far as I can remember. We all had that, okay? So, we are familiar with logic gates. So, in C++, let's take for an example, when you write an if statement, okay, suppose you are writing if A, and B equal to 1. Have you guys like used this statement in C++ or any programming language? This looks similar. Yes. Okay.
Yes.
This looks similar, right? So what exactly is happening here? What is this A and B? This A and B is basically representing an AND gate that you studied in last chapter of physics class 12. Okay. This is basically an AND gate. What this AND gate does is, this is your A is your input 1, B is your input 2. Okay. And this situation, this whole equation is checking whether the output of this AND gate, where A and B are the inputs, is equal to 1 or not. Okay. So this is the AND gate. Now, this is a very basic example of how you can use software or programming language to code out the hardware. This basic example here designs an AND gate. Now this is at the lowest possible complexity level, but when you go higher and higher up, you have similar constructs that will design multiplexers for you. From multiplexers, you go to adders, subtractors, multipliers, then you go to flip-flops. Your flip-flops are basically memory elements that store data. Okay. So if you want any detailed information about how Verilog or VSDL work, we can continue that after this session, or you can contact us personally, or YouTube, Google, all that is available. So this is a basic idea of how you can code out a hardware. Okay. Then after designing the hardware, as I said, second step is verification. Since you wrote the code, after that you have to run that code to see if it is working properly, if it is being compiled properly, if you did any syntax error, if you made any logical errors. Okay, like you wrote the whole code, it is compiling properly, but the results you're getting are wrong. That means you made some logical mistake. Okay. Similarly, after writing the code for any hardware IC that you're going to design, you have to simulate it, or you can say basic terms, verify it. Okay. Verification works on different levels. There are different types of verifications, but this is the second step. After designing, you have to verify if that's working or not. Once that is done, your code that is in a language that is similar to C++, not C++, a language whose syntax is similar to C++, a code that is on that level. May I interrupt? Yes, Ankur.
Yes, I'm really sorry to interrupt, but I was under the impression that when we design a PCB, we place individual components. So I was under the impression that for this, we place individual transistors. That doesn't happen. We use this programming language to design that.
Okay, so you are under a very obvious impression, which most of us do have, but that is not correct to PC. This whole program that we're going to write, in the end, this is going to translate to the transistor level on the PCB. Okay, example, like a very small PCB on a nanoscale level. But yeah, this whole thing is going to translate into that. But since
so basically place the components and tell us like how they have to be connected.
Okay. Wait. I'll just try to understand. Okay. So what you are talking about right now to this, suppose you open up any electronic device at your home. Okay. Say suppose you open up your phone. Okay. So you have a PCB over there, right?
Yeah.
It consists of many components, right? Resistor, capacitor, everything, right? Okay.
Yes.
What we are over here, what we're talking about, we are talking about an IC.
Yeah, I get that part. But yeah. I thought that in the IC on silicon, there's a whole array of like those various components, whatever they are.
Okay.
So yeah. I was under the impression that when that is designed, each and every component is placed by the designer in a certain way to make that architecture. So that doesn't happen. The programming takes
it. Okay. So what happens basically is, inside an IC, okay, you do not have separate components as resistors or capacitors or anything. Okay, everything is made up of transistors.
Basically.
Okay, so we use the transistors in various ways to come up, like to behave as resistor or capacitor or like that. Okay, so when we write out the code, okay, it creates a model of like how the transistors will look like. Like what will it simulate to? Like okay, so like now, right now, just show, right? So if you write if A and B is equal to 1, okay, so A and B that will transform to an AND gate, okay. And if you simplify it, AND gate again is composed of transistors.
Yeah.
Okay, so that is this. So okay, Rahul is saying so basically software automated generated circuit from our code to be printed. Yes, exactly, correct.
Basically the exact same question I have, the one which Rahul asked.
Yeah. This is the basic idea. I'm trying to open the software. If I can get that open, I'll give you guys a preview how the code translates into the circuit. But if not, I'm gonna explain it anyway. Okay.
Can you please introduce about FPGAs and Xilinx and how they're connected? Okay, yeah, we'll come to that.
We will cover that. Okay.
We'll come to that.
Okay, so electron. Yeah. Electron, whatever your real name is, it is in second year EC.
Okay.
Okay. Nice. Okay.
So we'll come to FPGAs also.
I want to make one point here. So basically the idea of designing hardware by coding is completely a digital thing. So you don't design an amplifier like that, or you don't process an analog signal like that. So for designing something which will process an analog signal, or which will accept or give you an analog signal, you have to design everything from a transistor. You will pick a single transistor, you will connect them, and then you will design them. There is no coding for designing anything analog. That is a basic difference between digital and analog. I hope I'm clear here.
Yeah, we will cover that. Okay, yeah, that is a very good point. I think I missed out on that part. Everything is not designed through code. Okay, but we'll cover that. Okay, nice. So
basically, we started off with this only, right? That we asked the question that how many of you are familiar with digital? So right now we are talking about digital. Right. So if you are designing an IC which processes digital signals, okay, in that case we use coding. And as Sumita just mentioned, if we have to come up with any IC which will process analog signals, for that you will have to manually pick and place components, and then you decide on that.
Okay.
I hope I'm clear.
That clarifies a lot. Thank you.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
So
please go ahead and ask such questions, man. Please.
Yeah. This will this will make the whole conversation much more clear for all of you. Even if anyone of you has any question, you can just turn on your mic and directly ask. We don't have an issue. Okay.
Or you can simply ask in chat box. It's very simple.
In chat or through whatever is comfortable. Or even if this whole presentation is seeming out of context to you, you can just say that out, and we can try to modify the context according to your liking. Okay.
You can just type. I am not getting anything like that.
Okay, so we'll continue with verification then.
So you guys can see the screen, right? After verification, once we have verified that our circuit, the code for our circuit, will probably work the way we want, then the third step is synthesis. Okay, so to give you an idea about, see, here is this step will clarify most of your questions that how can we code a hardware. Okay, so if I can show it, I'm not sure. Let me see.
Can you just please tell us what is the hardware that you're generating from this?
Yeah, tool? Let me just open it up and then I'll explain. It'll just take 1 minute. I'm not going deep into this. Nothing remotely related to that. I'm just going to give you an idea how a code translates into hardware code, hardware design. Okay. Yeah. So I believe you guys can see this, right? What is this symbol of? Most of you have completed digital, right? This is the symbol of an inverter, right? These are all inverters. This is the ground signal. This is your IC of the multiplexer that you're trying to make. Okay, inside this IC, wait, let me just. I don't know how do I, okay, zoom out. Nice. These are your components. This is how your flip-flop looks, a symbol of flip-flop. This is an inverter. This is your AND gate. I believe all of you can see that, right? This is a basic idea of how this what this whole thing is. You don't have to get into any detail. What I'm trying to show you is that, wait, what's this? Yeah, so. Okay, so to give you an idea, this is the code for a glitch-free MUX. How many of you know what a multiplexer is? Just raise your hands or like add plus one in chat.
And if anyone knows, just type in your answer what amongst is.
Yeah. Okay. Gurleen raised a hand. Okay. How many of you know what a multiplexer is? Electron raised a hand. Okay.
Okay, yeah, just
Gurleen,
speak up.
Okay, good. Nice. Kaushik raised the hand. Okay, nice. Okay, so nice. So most of you, some of you guys know what a multiplexer is. Other who don't know what a multiplexer is basically a device that works like an if and else statement. Okay, if A equals to 1, your output will be X. If A equals to 0, your output will be Y. Okay, a device on hardware level that works similar to this if and else equation multiplexer. I don't think you guys need to go into any more detail, but whoever doesn't know what multiplexer is, you can just Google it out. Very simple definition. Okay.
Okay. So basically, I'll just simplify this for you. Simple definition can be, suppose if you have multiple inputs, okay. And if you would like to choose one of the inputs based on a certain condition, then for that we use a mux.
Okay, so yeah, basically it is a hardware. It's a, what you can say, a hardware component, digital basic hardware building block. Okay, these AND gates and OR gates add up in a certain way to make a multiplexer that we abstractly used in our design so commonly. Okay, so this is a design of a glitch free multiplexer. Okay, this is used in clock domain crossing and other cases. I don't think anyone needs to go into that, but this is what you can say, advanced version of a basic multiplexer. Okay, so you can see what Verilog looks like. I have defined inputs, what will be the inputs of my IC. I have defined output, what will be the output of my IC, input pins and output pins. Okay, these are the internal wires, how internal wires are connected inside the IC. Okay, you can see basic statements. I am assigning one signal to another signal. Okay, these are the constructs that I don't think you need to go in depth, but you'll understand once you start there. Okay, these are basically, can you tell us more about verification? Says okay. We'll cover that. Okay, yeah, we'll cover that. Nice. Some of you, if any IEEE member is here, you just keep a note of these questions. Okay, we'll address them in the end if we don't get time. Otherwise, we'll try to address them side by side. But do keep a note of these questions. Okay. So these are the basic assigned statements. This tilde symbol is of NOT gate. What this whole statement is doing is, this is equivalent to this statement that my cursor is at. This is equivalent to, wait, let me see, what was that statement? Q, A, B, C, and I'm noting that and I'm ending that all. Okay. So this is equivalent to this. A, B, C. Okay, this is an AND gate. I think all of you guys are familiar with this basic digital construct. Okay, this is a NOT gate inverter. This is an AND gate. The statement that I showed you there, this statement, what it is doing is giving you a code for this circuit. Okay, so if you can write this, if you can design the circuit, this circuit in this format, wouldn't this be easier to design? Yes, Ankur. Okay, I think that was understood. Yeah, so this is the whole design. In this way, we can design different blocks of your whole digital IC, different components of your IC, club them all together in a single code. And then that code can be verified through simulation. Okay. This is how that code. Yeah, this is how that code is converted. Okay, all these tiny gates that you're saying, all these gates are converted from this code. Okay, this converts to something, some component. This statement converts. Just like that, you can design the whole, you can say, circuit, digital circuit, in the format of a code. Once you are done with designing the circuit, you simulate the design. Okay. Basic step for simulation, basic step for verification is basic, simple waveform simulation. Okay. But once you get deeper into that, deeper into VLSI, and you start looking into different job profiles, your verification is then divided into different aspects, formal verification, emulation, validation, hardware acceleration, and all that. Okay. Yeah. So what do you do from that? Okay. So does anyone remember these were the input pins of my IC that I designed? Okay. And this was the output pin. What I'm doing is I'm applying different values to all those input pins, and I'm checking if the output of my whole circuit at the output pin is same as what I'm expecting my design to work like. Okay, this is how your basic verification works. After verification, I said third step was synthesis. The synthesis step was converting your code after verification, converting your code into a format that can translate and resemble your gate level netlist. Gate level netlist is a whole code that is written in the form of gates, like the schematic you saw here. Okay, let me just elaborate it once again. Yeah. You saw the schematic, right? This process of translating the code into this format can be called synthesis. Now the code won't be converted into a diagram. It will just be converted into another code that resembles exactly this diagram. Okay. That means your if and else constructs will no longer be there. Okay. Those if and else will be replaced by AND and OR gates, NAND gates, NOR gates. Okay. After your synthesis, next step is your DFT. We will cover this step. This is basically what I do. Okay, this is my job. We'll cover this step after we're done with the whole flow. Okay, as far as you are concerned, this step did not exist 10 years ago or 20 years ago and wasn't half as popular in the whole, designing process. Okay, so even if we skip this step, chances are we're going to make our IC just as good as we were going to make it before DFT. Okay. But this is
We have one question from Gulin.
Okay, yeah.
He's asking that can you tell us more about the verification stage? Okay, that we have already discussed, and how Verilog verification is different from system Verilog. So could you just
What was the second question again?
Difference between Verilog and system Verilog.
Okay, yeah, we'll cover that too. Okay, just give me a minute. Let me complete the flow. And then we'll cover all the questions related to this flow one by one. Okay. Once this whole flow is complete, it's nice you asked that question. We'll keep a note of that. Okay. After this, your fifth step is, I think that is your layout designing. Now this layout designing, very broad field, you can say fifth, sixth, and seventh steps. This layout designing comprises of first designing the layout, then doing tamping analysis, then doing a temperature analysis. So there are couple of steps in this one single step. So I'm just going to write it out like this. Okay. Fifth, sixth, and seventh step. These are layout designing. Now, what does layout designing mean? Okay. What does layout designing mean? Okay. So as far as we have discussed, after verification, we convert our code into a abstraction level that resembles the exact AND gates, NOT gates, OR gates, NAND gates, basic gates, okay, which all of you are familiar with. Basic non-complex digital elements. Okay, after synthesis, you convert your code into that form. Now what you do in layout is you pick and place all those components into different locations in your IC. Okay. What I mean by that is, just pick one, man. Okay, I have no idea why this is. So yeah, so what I'm saying is, this is your area for the IC. Okay, this area you secured at this much area I want. Okay, suppose this is, I'd say this is 40 micrometer. Okay, these ICs are very small. Very, very small. Okay, you can say 40 millimeter square. This is the area of the IC that you want. I don't want my IC to be bigger than this, or this IC will not fit into the mobile phone that I'm trying to create. Okay, let's take that for an example. So now what we'll do is, the whole, what you can say, your code is converted into small gates. Okay, what you'll do is place those components or gates on different locations. Okay, now these gates are not exactly gates, they are in form of blocks or standard cells. Are like a big logical circuit that works as a stencil or a predefined block. Okay, now we have, and suppose we have an ADC or not an ADC, we have RAM that we want to insert in our SoC. Now, like in our computers, RAM sticks are like added externally, not a part of a processor, but they do have a defined area and they are already manufactured in a specific way before we try to assemble our PC. Okay, so we do know how much area this RAM is going to occupy. So suppose we have blocks similar to RAM, okay, standard blocks that we are going to insert. So what this layout step does is, the layout engineer places different components. This layout engineer places different components at different places so that we can optimize the area. Okay, just like PCB designing, how your PCB is designed. This is a more complex version of PCB designing. You are just placing the components, blocks and all that. On the area that you're designated, and then you route that whole area. Okay, you check for power, how much power is leaking, you check for temperature, what are the temperatures on different blocks, is it exceeding the temperature limits, what speed does it work on and all that. Okay, so that is the point of your layout designing. After layout, this is the main part. What you do is, after your whole layout is like completed, convert that layout into this format. Okay, this is a file and GDS2 is the extension, you can say like that. Okay, so this is the format. This format is given to the manufacturing unit. Okay, this format consists every detailed information about the IC that you have so far incorporated into the design. Okay, once you give this format to the manufacturer, the foundry, you can say fabricates the IC. After that, your IC is done, you can start the testing process and all that. Okay, so this is so far the process, and I'm pretty sure most of you have so many doubts. Okay, so let's start covering the doubts. So far we have Gurleen's doubt, difference between Verilog and system Verilog and all those verification technologies. Okay, apart from that, you guys have any doubts, just raise the question or like speak up.
Okay, one question from my side to everyone. Are you clear with the overview? Like, have you understand the whole overview? Just yes or no?
Do you guys now
because
after
it's
this?
It's a lot to take in. Okay, I understand it's a lot to take in. Maybe you can just note all these things, and later on you can Google and you can see. If not, you can just get back to Suresh.
Yeah, you can get in touch again. Okay, what I want to ask is, are you guys? Did you guys understand the basic idea of what I tried to explain? Yes.
Let's come on.
Okay.
Yes or no? Yes or no? Okay. What is DFT? Basic steps are clear. Okay. What is DFT? So it's just a brief on DFT.
Yeah. Okay. First, let me cover Gurlin's question on sure. difference between Verilog and System Verilog. So, see Gurlin. You can see four languages here. Okay. First is VHDL. VHDL is the VHDL syntax is the closest to your hardware description. Okay. That means VHDL does not look like your basic C++ or C. Okay. This is more like a third world language that has a very rigid structure. A very strict syntax that you use to exactly define how the hardware will look like. Okay, so like in C++, you start a block by curly braces and end it by curly braces, right? In Verilog, you start a block by writing begin instead of curly braces. You write begin. You end it instead of closing curly braces. You end it with end. These are the keywords. In VHDL, you use syntax like entity, architecture, okay. All those syntaxes, you can't just write A plus B equals to C in VHDL. You have to write it in a, like you can write it, but that won't translate to something consequential, okay. So you have to write it in a very strict prohibited syntax so that it can match very closely to the hardware. Verilog gives you much more freedom. It is a language that resembles C and C++. Okay, here you can see these statements. This equals to sign, this looks somewhat like a normal equal to sign, apart from the fact that it looks like an arrow and it has a different meaning. But on its basic idea of this block between begin and end is, I'm assigning four values to four different variables. Okay. And these four different variables will act as four different cells in my hardware. Okay. This is what your Verilog looks like. In VHDL, this will be written in a much more complicated way. Now, what System Verilog does is, since I'm not an expert in System Verilog by far, my work most probably by now resides with Verilog, okay, and scripting. But as far as I can tell, System Verilog gives you more freedom. Okay. It allows you to add the concepts of hooks, to define classes, structures, functions, use those classes. Okay. Yeah, Sumita, you were saying.
You can continue, sir.
I thought your mic just turned on, so you might have wanted to say something. Yeah. So System Verilog allows you more freedom to create a virtual environment and test your IC in that virtual environment. Okay. Verilog allows you to test your IC through this. Like I showed you that simulation, right? Waveform. Okay. You can basically verify that through waveform. At this college level, what you're doing, you can verify that through waveform. In System Verilog, you can create classes. You can create loops. Okay. Okay. See. So here's the basic idea of one thing known as synthesizable and non-synthesizable construct. I will not go into deep as that will take a lot of time. But basic idea is a for loop that goes to infinity cannot be synthesized because there is no such thing that can repeat itself infinite times on hardware. Okay, you can do that on software, you cannot do that on hardware. So for loop that goes to infinity or while one loop that is non-synthesizable Whereas an if and else statement is synthesizable that can be converted into a multiplexer. Okay, so there are different things. System log allows you to verify your design using OOPs and using non-synthesizable constructs that allow you the freedom of changing your design and testing it in all cases. Now, system Verilog is basically not used as a designing language, but more as a verification language. Okay, what I mean by that is, you don't want your system Verilog code to be converted into a gate level netlist. You don't want your system Verilog code to be converted into basic digital components. What you want is, you wrote a code in Verilog, you want a system Verilog code to generate all possible list of possible scenarios, of possible values, those signals that are in your Verilog code will take. Okay, so okay, let me just give you a basic idea. What I'm saying is, this is a Verilog code. Okay, this whole code will be converted into a netlist, a gate level. This will be converted into gates. But now to check this code, suppose this Verilog IC, this will be having some inputs and it will be having some outputs. Okay. What system Verilog allows you is to create a wrapper and provide values to this inputs and output values, all possible values that you can think of. So that you can rigorously test your Verilog code through system Verilog assertions. Okay, if that makes any sense. So Verilog and system Verilog, although they are quite similar, they are not used in the same context. One is used for designing, other one is used for verification. And system C is one step higher than system Verilog, allows you to combine C and Verilog and even more of OOPs into that. Okay, I hope that clears your question. Does it? Does that clear your question? Yes, it does. Okay. What other questions we had? DFT.
Just give a brief over DFT first.
Okay. So what DFT does is basically the idea behind DFT stands for Design for Testability. Let's just write it here. Okay. DFT stands for Design for Testability. So what you do is, once you have your IC. This is your IC, these are your inputs, and these are your can be verified using Verilog. Yes, you can verify using Verilog. Yes. What the advantage of system Verilog over Verilog is, once the design gets very complicated, system Verilog allows you to write loops, to write classes and use those classes and functions again and again, whereas Verilog does not provide you that flexibility. Okay, so system Verilog makes it easier for you to verify the design, even though same thing can be done with Verilog. Okay, so here it is. Suppose this is your IC. It is manufactured, you have the hardware IC. Now you have to test this IC, if everything has been fabricated properly or not. What you'll do is, use a test, like add this to a tester and test this IC. Now, 10 years ago, when DFT was not introduced, what the scenario was, you could not tell where exactly was the fault of the IC. You provide inputs to the IC, you check the outputs. If the outputs are as expected, the IC is working fine. If the outputs are not as you expected, the IC is not working fine. You could not pinpoint the exact location inside the whole IC, which exactly is causing the problem. Using DFT, you can do that. Okay. That is the basic idea. DFT is basically, comes after synthesis, you write a separate design, what you can say, you write an architecture that embeds your main design and then that helps during testing. Okay. Any question? Any other question?
Hello. Okay. Yeah, so here's one more question. So let's say when designing a microcontroller, so like various parts of the microcontroller, like the resistors or let's say the ALU, are they designed individually and then placed together, or like the whole thing is designed in one go?
No, see, what happens during designing? Okay, so microcontroller consists of your registers, your cache memory, okay, inbuilt memory, and your ALUs, and what you can say, your ADC and all that, okay, different components. So what you'll do is, what basically how this thing goes in the industry is, different engineers will design different components of this microcontroller. Okay, all those engineers will synthesize their components and then provide it to the layout engineer. That layout engineer will take components from different engineers and place that on the IC and route it out. Does that clear your point?
It does.
Yeah. Okay. So, yeah.
Okay.
Apart from yeah. So let's get back to the presentation. This has already been extended. Okay, sorry. Yeah, so we had this design. Now let's go to the roles of, okay, Sumita, would you like to take it on from here?
No, you can carry on, sir.
No, I'll just be wobbling up everything. Okay, so yeah, roles of a VLSI engineer. Okay, so there are different positions you can work in as a VLSI engineer. Okay. First is your design engineer. Okay, so this is one thing. These are all terms that you guys are new to, I understand. And you guys, most of you will be seeing these terms for the first time. But hopefully we can give you a brief idea about that. So one role as a VLSI engineer is design engineer. Let's just focus on this. First is design engineer, then is verification engineer. Okay, we have design engineer, we have verification engineer. Apart from that, we have CAD engineers, application engineers, marketing. Okay. There are different types of design engineers. Okay. First is ASIC design engineer, ASIC. Second is FPGA design engineer. Analog mixed signal, DFT, that I am working as AMS, analog mixed signal, DFT design engineer. Okay, and then your customized CNPC. I'd say CIC and PCB. Okay, so what is basically the role of, what does ASIC mean? Let us focus on this one. Application specific integrated circuit. Okay, so ASIC is, what you can say, a very fancy term for an IC. Application specific integrated circuit is a fancy term for a simple term that you know as integrated circuit, IC. Okay, what this means is, you are designing an IC for a specific requirement. As I said, every time you design an ASIC, ASIC, the first step will be asking for the specifications. As I said, before design, you need the specifications. Every time the specifications will be different based on the application that IC is going to be used in. Okay. And each time you design this IC based on different specification, it's called an ASIC. It's as simple as that. The whole flow that I explained to you, that was the ASIC design flow. This application specific integrated circuit design flow. Okay, there's nothing new in that. FPGA is something you guys were asking to, and it's different. Okay, so how many of you know here what an FPGA is? How many of you know here what an FPGA is? No idea. Okay, how many of you have heard that term FPGA?
No one? Guys, please answer.
Yeah, so Electron has. Is Shubham here? Shubham Roy?
Electron.
Dibashu, Shubham here?
Yes, yeah, Shubham's here.
Shubham's here. Okay, Shubham, would you like to cover this topic? What an FPGA means? What exactly it is?
No, it's Shubham, so I left the meeting. Yeah.
What?
Shubham had left the meeting.
He left it just now, or he left it like?
No, he left before.
Shubham has left the meeting. Please continue. Well, that is sad. Okay. Yeah. So
okay,
basically.
Fine. Oh, okay.
Yeah, Sumita, you explain. Yeah, sure. Yes.
Okay, fine. Oh, so let's say, do you guys know, like, these ICs cost way too much? Like, designing one, you can't ask to a fabricator, you can't go to Intel and ask them, I need a processor with these specifications. Like, it will cost you crores of amount to design one IC. So, how do they, you know, make money from that? So, what did they do is, वो एक ही आईसी के दे विल मेक 100 लाइक नॉट 100 मेबी मिलियंस ऑफ आईसीज टू कॉम्पनसेट एंड देन ईच ऑफ दोज आईसी विल कॉस्ट अ वेरी स्मॉल अमाउंट सो द थिंग इज बट देयर आर फ्यू एप्लीकेशंस लाइक इफ यू आर डिजाइनिंग समथिंग फॉर अ मिसाइल यू कांट प्रोड्यूस दैट इन मिलियन नंबर ऑफ यू कांट प्रोड्यूस दैट स्पेसिफिक आईसी इन मिलियन नंबर्स बिकॉज You're not designing missile in million numbers. Laptops we are designing, but for a missile, you'll hardly need one or two. So in that case, designing specific IC for one missile will cost too much. So what do we do in that case is, we design FPGAs. So FPGAs are basic hardware which you can control and you can design anything you want from that FPGA. Let's say for your project, you know, BCD, binary to decimal converter. How many of you know binary to decimal converter? Please let me know. Am I audible? How many of you know binary to decimal converter?
Okay,
just
yes,
answer.
Yeah.
That is you guys know. Okay. So if you need to design that, and if you go to Intel and tell them that I need a binary to digital converter, and that is a very specific task. You don't need that IC in millions. You need only one, or let's say 10. You need so will you agree to pay crores of amount for just 10 of those ICs? So it's you won't, right? So these FPGAs are hardware that they will provide you, and you can tune them. Like if you want a FPGA, if you want to make a BCD or any hardware according to your specification, according to your functionality, you can just turn them. You can just code that FPGA and you can get the functionality you want. So if you're designing something for a missile, you want that, you don't need that in hundreds of amount. You'll barely need 4 or 5. So that's
so
where FPGA comes into picture. Is that clear?
Is that clear?
Yeah, okay, we'll
are you guys getting how FPGA is different from ASIC?
Yes, okay, that seems clear. Okay, so the example that Sumita gave, so let me just give you a brief point. The example that Sumita gave was, if you want if you want a simple chip for a missile, okay, you want and those 10-20 missiles that you are going to make, you won't be straightforward. Now, even though at the end those chips that you're trying to make will be made in the form of ASIC, those will not be used as an FPGA onto the missile in most cases, because ASIC provides you more reliability. Okay, in most cases, in the end you will get that IC, okay, that manufactured IC, but before you get that manufactured IC, all the testing will be done on FPGA, because you cannot afford to, what you can say, use, reuse and throw those ICs. Okay, so FPGA adds a very strong suit to your ASIC designing, that is testing. Before your sometimes and most times before is made, you write the whole code, you synthesize it, then you try. Even phones have FPGAs. Okay. Is Shubham Roy here? I was IEEE mate.
Yeah.
Who was using IEEE mate?
Ravi, maybe.
Ravi was testing through his different ID. Okay, whatever, whoever that. I think that would be one. Can you please suggest some sources? Yeah, we will. Sure. As I was saying, field programmable gate arrays, FPGAs, are majorly used to test and, what you can say, develop a prototype for your ICs before you go on and manufacture them. Okay, you want to be able to make sure that your IC is working exactly the way you want without having to invest into the whole manufacturing cost. Then what you'll do is write the code, synthesize the IC, do all the processes you already did, layout, and your timing analysis, your temperature analysis, most of those processes, not exactly temperature analysis, but most of those processes on the of the VLSI flow, IC flow, you will do that before implementing that into FPGA 2. But instead of sending the whole end final netlist file to the manufacturer, you will upload the bit file onto the FPGA and implement the whole thing onto an FPGA and see if the whole thing is working properly or not. Okay, just as a safety measure. Now, for startups or for companies who are not making products that are to be distributed onto mass scale, okay, products that are very limited in number, FPGA is a very viable option, because since those products are not going to be sold into masses, there's no way you can recover the cost of manufacturing. So why not go onto a cheaper option that provides you most of the reliability of what I can provide, leaves no flex, like gives you very all the flexible options of an ASIC, most of the flexible options of an ASIC, unless your design is too complicated to be implemented onto FPGAs, gives you most of the options and allows you to implement your design without having to invest so much into manufacturing. Okay, so that is where FPGAs are used. Yeah, next is analog mixed signal, and that is the forte of.
There is a question: is programming FPGA similar to STL? So I think
is programming similar to FPGA similar to?
Yeah.
Is programming FPGA similar to HDL?
Okay.
HDL.
So what which you are asking is Verilog. Like Verilog is a HDL. Okay.
Yeah.
So your question is Verilog same as like FPGA programming? So it's not actually same. So when you're writing a Verilog code, you'll be giving that code or you're giving that design to any company, and they will give you a IC, right? And while writing a code to FPGA, so you will get a FPGA that is a hardware, and you will write some code in like in Xilinx, and then you will burn that code into that hardware, and now that hardware will behave whatever the code you have written. Is it clear? Should I explain? And Jan Ankur, is it clear?
Yes.
Yeah. So see, let me just clear it a bit once again. As I explained to you the whole process, this last step was a GDS to netlist, right? This was the file format that was given to the manufacturing or fabrication foundry, okay, manufacturing unit, so that they can, what you can say, fabricate an IC, make an IC for you. Instead of converting the whole thing into a GDS2 format, what you do in FPGA is convert it into a bitstream file. These steps till here, till testability, all the steps are same in FPGA. Or till synthesis. Okay, sorry, my bad. Till synthesis, all the steps are same in FPGA. After synthesis, sometimes you do layout designing, sometimes you don't. But after synthesis, you convert the whole thing into a bitstream file and you upload it onto an FPGA. This thing that you're seeing here, this is an FPGA software. Okay, so I cannot directly convert this Verilog code into a GDS2 file, because I don't have the resource to do that, because company have their proprietary softwares. Okay, but what I can do is, this whole thing is free of like available to you free, at least the student version is available for free. You can write the code. Okay, here is something you'll see, run synthesis. Okay, if I connect an FPGA with my laptop and then run synthesis, this whole code will be synthesized and converted into gate level netlist. The whole code will be converted into format that consists of gates. Then that thing can be implemented. Okay, see this thing you will be seeing, generate bit stream. I think you guys can see this. Wait. Yeah. This I think you guys can see. Once your design is synthesized, after that you can convert it into a bitstream format. That this bitstream format is similar to the format of GDS2 that you use in ASIC. Okay, you convert it into a bitstream format. You connect your FPGA to a laptop using the USB port and whatever port it is on the other end. Then you upload this bitstream file onto your FPGA, and your FPGA will be modeled to work like the code that you have designed it. You understand? Does that give you an idea? Hello.
Yeah, okay, we can go ahead.
Yeah.
Okay, we have one new question. And I think it's right up to cover it. What is the role of Xilinx?
Okay, so would you like to cover it? Nita?
Okay. Oh, fine. Yeah. So Xilinx, the software you can see over the screen. So basically, we use that software to write codes you can see these lines. We write those codes to make a FPGA work. To burn a code in FPGA. So Xilinx just provides a software. It's just the name of the company that provides the software.
Xilinx is basically the company that provides the software and the FPGA, like it manufactures the FPGA. Okay. It's like similar to your Arduino. Okay, so Arduino provides you the ID, Arduino ID, and provides you the board. Right? So yeah, Xilinx is like that. Next, okay, so I think we are running short on time. We'll cover it quickly. Next is AMS. Sumita?
Yeah. Analog mixed design. Okay, so analog signals. I hope you all know what analog signal means. So anything like sound, light, anything analog. So while designing analog circuits, you can't code them. Like there's no software where you can like write. Let's say you need to design an amplifier which has a gain of 5,000. You can't write that Vout by V should be 5,000. You have to pick up individual transistors and design them such that it will give you a small signal gain of 5,000. So and you'll be designing everything from MOSFETs these days. Earlier we used to use BJTs, but now.
Sumita, you're not audible.
Have you seen that silicon wafer, that round silicon wafer? Let me know if you have seen that. Or else I can show you. So just let me know if.
I don't think anybody has seen that before.
So just Google that wafer. Silicon, just type silicon wafer in your phone.
Okay, I'll just share my screen.
Yeah, okay, nice.
So yeah, that silicon wafer. So you can see those horizontal and vertical cuts. Those small rectangles will make one chip. So now the thing is, while designing these wafers, while designing these chips, we need to, you know, अभी इन लोगों ने वो नहीं पढ़ाना फैब्रिकेशन के स्टेप्स वगैरह, सेकंड ईयर में तो नहीं पढ़ाते ना।
फैब्रिकेशन के स्टेप्स DLSI में आते ना, जो मैंने कवर कराया।
फैब्रिक वो यार वो वाले स्टेप मतलब
अच्छा वो, अच्छा ठीक है ठीक है। वो क्या बोलते हैं,
स्केचिंग
लिथोग्राफी
वगैरह वाले स्टेप, स्केचिंग वगैरह
एंड
के
ऑल
स्टेप,
दैट। हाँ
थर्ड ईयर
आई
लिथोग्राफी। या लिथोग्राफी तो या
डोंट थिंक
लिथोग्राफी
लाइक पर
व्हाइल परफॉर्मिंग लिथोग्राफी सो यू हैव टू रिमूव सम मटेरियल्स एंड पुट सम मटेरियल ओवर देयर। सो लेट्स से यू आर डिजाइनिंग सिलिकॉन ऑक्साइड, सो इट इज इम्पॉसिबल टू मेक अ यूनिफॉर्म सिलिकॉन ऑक्साइड ओवर एंटायर चिप। सो इफ द राइट हाफ सो यू कांट पुट सिंगल सिंगल एटम देयर एंड मेक देम आइडेंटिकल। सो व्हाइल डिजाइनिंग देम यू कांट मेक देम आइडेंटिकल, सो दैट इज कॉल्ड एज प्रोसेस वेरिएशन। सो देयर विल बी सम प्रोसेस अपार्ट फ्रॉम प्रोसेस वेरिएशन। योर चिप शुड वर्क एट डिफरेंट टेम्परेचर राइट, सो इट शुड वर्क फ्रॉम -40 डिग्री सेंटीग्रेड टू 125 डिग्री सेंटीग्रेड। दैट इज द रेंज वी एनालॉग डिजाइनर इंजीनियर्स कवर। एंड अपार्ट फ्रॉम दैट सो लेट्स से योर फोन और योर लैपटॉप हैज सम वोल्टेज ऑफ लाइक 5 वोल्ट, सो फॉर 5 वोल्ट इट इज वर्किंग। सो अप टू सो इट शुड ऑल्सो वर्क फॉर 4.9, 4.8, 4.7, अप टू सम लिमिट इट शुड वर्क। यू कांट मेक योर बैटरी टू 5 वोल्ट ऑल द टाइम, सो दैट इज कॉल्ड एन सप्लाई वेरिएशन। सो दीज
या
टाइप ऑफ वेरिएशन, सो टू कवर दीज टाइप ऑफ वेरिएशन वी नीड BGR सर्किट्स, LDO सर्किट्स एंड देर आर सो मेनी थिंग्स। सो दैट्स द जॉब ऑफ एनालॉग डिजाइन इंजीनियर टू मेक होल AC वर्क at different temperature, at different voltage, and at different process. So this is quite the job of an analog IC designer.
Ankur, in starting you had mentioned about PCB, right? So this is one of the roles also. Okay, so PCB, as you said, okay, now whatever we have covered in the form of an IC. Okay, but when it comes to a product, okay, you have to integrate many things with your IC. Okay, in order to for the IC to work. Okay, so it will comprise of your inputs and outputs from your sensors or buttons. And similarly, the outputs to your LCD screens, LEDs, and all those things. So that in that case, we have the PCB that comes in. Okay, wherein we use various tools. Okay, anyone has used any PCB design tool? Okay, I know that IEEE has already conducted PCB design workshops. So if anyone has, just could you tell what are some PCB design tools? Anyone? Eagle. Okay. Yeah. So, okay. So, Eagle is one famous tool we have for PC designing. Okay. So, in that, what we do is we can place the components, and according to that, we design. Okay. Like, what will be our, what will be the placement of our components. Okay. That is what PCB board design is all about. Okay. And,
Screen not visible. The conscious screen is not visible.
Yeah, just one minute. Now it's, yeah, it's been just I just shared the screen. Now is it visible?
Yeah, it's
yeah,
visible.
okay. So then we'll move ahead to other domains. Okay. So we have front-end verification, acceleration, emulation, product validation, and verification. So it's just one liners on this.
Okay, so yeah, can you just full screen that?
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, so we have design engineer domains. I think we covered most of them. Then we have front-end verification, that is simulation. So front-end verification is basically like providing the inputs to your design and checking the outputs. Okay, just like I showed you the waveform of that 4x1 glitch-free multiplexer. The waveform that I showed you, that is the very basic idea of what front-end verification looks like. Okay, now it will not just be all waveforms. You can see waveform of 1,000 signals going over the span of hours. Okay, you cannot see that, but that is just a basic idea what that is similar to. Okay, that goes more in depth, but that's basic idea. Acceleration and emulation. Okay, so there are two types of validation. One is validating the EDA tools. Okay, validating EDA tools means, what are EDA tools? The tools, the softwares that you use to design an IC. At different stages, you need tools for designing, verification, synthesis. For DFT, you need tools. For layout, you need different tools. For temperature analysis, you need different tools. All those different tools, those are called EDA tools. Okay, so the product validation engineer, what they do is verify those EDA tools. Okay, check the proper functioning of those EDA tools, if all the features are working properly, if all random cases have been incorporated. Okay, if it can, if the tool can, what you can say, if the tool can bear the size of the file that we are going to upload, and all those details. The whole tool designing and validation part that comes into product validation. The other type of validation is emulation. So what I told you for this, that prototyping is done on FPGAs. Okay, that is the basic idea of emulation. What you do in emulation is run verification through very high speed simulations, either on very high end FPGAs or supercomputers. Okay, so that is before implementing the whole design on hardware on the IC, you try to implement the whole design on sort of a computer or an FPGA, a similar device that can provide you the similarities of in hardware without having to manufacture an IC. That is the part of emulation. And after that, verification, IP implementation, these are like test bench. So I don't think anyone is familiar with test bench. What a test bench is, you write a design in Verilog or any VSD language. You need to test that design. So the code, another extra code that is used to test that design, okay, for all possible cases, that code is called a test bench. So a test bench developer makes test bench for different types of IPs. Just like a design engineer writes the code, but slightly different way. Okay, slightly for a different purpose. Just that. I think that is clear. Is that clear?
Okay. Now that's clear. Okay, we'll move ahead. So what are the basic requirements you need to have for VLSI and embedded? Okay. So you should, okay. Now, you have seen that whatever codes we write or whatever designs we do, you need a basic understanding of the digital, right? So how a MUX transistor, how the gates and the MUX, they work. So you should have a strong hold on digital economy. Okay. Then again, good at programming and scripting. Okay. So these two go hand in hand. Okay. So like if I'm writing and if statement, like if I've written A and B, okay. So I should know that this will transform to an AND gate. Similarly, if I want an AND gate, I should know what should be the corresponding programming line for that. So what should be the syntax corresponding syntax for that? So these two go hand in hand. You should be good in digital electronics as well as programming. Okay. Then good at network analysis and circuit design. Fish, these 2 points.
Yeah, basic network analysis, yeah, your Kirchhoff's and all those current voltage and all that. That is the part of analog, I don't touch analog. So with that, if you'd like to shed light, that will be fine.
Yeah, apart from Kirchhoff's and basic, you should also know Fourier and Laplace transforms too, because sometimes it's very comfortable to analyze your circuit in frequency domain rather than in time domain. Sometimes equations are too messy to deal with when it comes to time domain. So it's good, yes, if you know Laplace and Fourier to deal your circuit in frequency domain. You'll understand, yeah, these things. Since most of them are in first and second, it's not very much to comment on. You, as you, Laplace, we study in second year or third year?
Laplace is secondary.
Laplace and Fourier transform, all these transforms you study in mathematics.
So you will understand the importance. I guess probably in third year. I don't remember exactly, but it's
very helpful.
They'll ask you if you're interviewing for analog design profile. They'll definitely ask you. You should know this.
At least for analog, you need to know that. As far as I've been with digital, they don't ask, but still basic understanding should be there. What exactly this thing is, okay? And then you have device physics, knowledge of semiconductors, how all that thing works, okay?
Yeah.
All that.
Yeah. Okay, embedded. Okay, you should have a good hand over this programming. So okay, now since I have been working in embedded domain, so it's not like you should know a particular language. Like you need a Java.
We'll cover.
Yeah. You should just know at least one language, C++, anything. Okay. And once you know any one particular language, you develop the logics, right? How you can come up with a solution for any problem. So once you have that logic, you can program that in any language. Okay, because only the difference there is syntax and all those things. So you should have a good C++. Then you should be familiar with computer architecture. Okay, and the major thing is comfortable working with hardware. Okay. This reminds me of one tip that I would like to give to all of you. Okay. So when I had taken up EC, okay, I had one notion in mind that I'll be working with electronics, I'll be working with hardware and all those stuff, and I will not have to do programming and all those stuff. Okay. But later on, as I move forward in my second year, third year, fourth year. By the time third year came in, I realized that okay, no, this is not the case. Whatever I do, if I go into VLSI or if I go into an embedded or if I go anywhere in electronics, I will be needing at least a basic understanding of programming languages. Without programming, without coding, I cannot survive in the electronic industry. Okay, just a tip.
Answer this question from Parth Arora. How do we need to drive in a language? That is, should we be focusing on data structures and algo?
Okay.
Yeah. So, are you asking this for embedded or are you asking this for VLSI?
Just answer from both perspective. I think it will be helpful for
you. Devanshu, you'd like to cover or should I?
As of now, right now I've been working in embedded for the past 7 months or so. Okay, so in my case, what I have seen mostly is when you start working in companies, right? Okay, so you should have a basic understanding of data structures and algorithms. Okay, so like pointers and linked lists and all this stuff, you should have a basic understanding, and you should also know how you can code them. Okay, but when it comes to working in a company, what mostly we do is we have some inbuilt libraries and inbuilt functions which we use directly. Okay, so what we do is we directly call those functions, and the functions take care of all those things. But you should have a knowledge of how the pointers work, because when it comes to debugging your code, okay, so suppose you have given some inputs and you're not getting the required output, so you should know that where it went wrong. So in that case, you should know how those internal functions are working. So for that, you need to have the knowledge of data structures and all. So basic understanding is important. Okay, this concept of basic understanding is required. Okay, I'm not saying that you go totally in depth, but you need to have a basic understanding. And I'll tell you, once you start working, you'll get to learn as you work. Can explain about embedded C programming and bare metal programming. I'm currently working in STM nuclear board. I'm not. What is bare metal programming? Okay, Suyash, bare metal programming. Okay, honestly, I do not have any idea about bare metal programming. If Suyash is in the, if you know, then please go ahead.
No, I also don't know anything about that.
I don't think most people in their college time do encounter bare metal programming. Okay. I mean, see, bare metal programming is basically, it works on different abstraction levels. So you do have to have the knowledge of computer architecture. So if you're working with STM32 nuclear, whatever board you're working with, okay, I have not worked with that board, but as far as I can tell, you do need to have a proper understanding of how the registers are placed in that. Okay, so if I am to explain this, this is bare metal programming, you can say is somewhat of an amalgamation of your basic higher abstraction level C++, not C++, whatever language you prefer, and your embedded C assembly, and down to the bottom level, okay, assembly that we have.
Have you worked on Arduino and AVR, like those microcontrollers? Have you worked on those things?
Okay, Parth will cover your question. Sumita is asking Electron. Electron, have you worked on Arduino or anything before? He's asking.
Okay, when it comes to this, we are not talking about LFRs, please.
Yeah, yeah. Okay. What other microcontrollers have you worked on apart from Arduino and NodeMCU? Okay, Arduino and NodeMCU are basically your, what you can say, work on a very higher level of abstraction. Those languages are very much similar to C++. So you can't say, I can't say you do have a very good understanding. From that, I cannot tell if you have a very good understanding of architecture and how computer architecture works, microcontroller architecture works. But
to understand this whole scenario, you need to understand the architecture. Working with Arduino is nothing. Like, you can learn Arduino like in 2 days. It's nothing.
Yeah, I mean, these days, 9th, 10th class or 8th class students are learning Arduino. So that is not something you can consider as a microcontroller anymore.
Okay.
Let me try to explain what your question. Okay. So, working with assembly help us understand that I have knowledge of ARM architecture. Okay. Electron, can you turn on your mic and ask your question properly in detail again, or just type it?
I would prefer you to turn on your mic.
Whatever you prefer, okay. From what I have figured out, you're working on STM32, okay? And you want to know about bare metal programming. Am I right? I have knowledge of, okay, yes, I'm right, okay, see. So bare metal programming is not exactly a term we use. Okay, it's just, how can I explain this? Bare metal programming is just a term given, like a sort of a nickname that is used to identify something. Okay? Like, yes, exactly, like driver development. So bare metal programming is like programming without any OS. Okay, bare metal programming is writing firmware, which has exactly without any OS. So in your C++ programs, in Arduino programs, you do need an OS. Like compile your code and convert all that, okay? But once you work at an abstraction level that is much lower than the system level, pertaining something similar to assembly or embedded C, you need to have the knowledge of your, if you're working on STM32, you need to have the knowledge of your STM32 microcontroller. Like what are the clocks? What are the frequency? If you want to implement a timer, what's the clock frequency at which the timer is working? What are the bits in each register that I need to change so as to set the configuration of the timer exactly to the way I want it to be implemented? Okay, you want to know what cache is available, you want to know how interrupts are implemented, you want to know at what rate polling is done in your controller, you want to know how much, what's the size of your ADC, 10-bit, 8-bit, okay. You want to know all these details and you want to understand how the ALU is exactly configured. It can be said somewhat similar to the NT86 that you study. it can be said somewhat similar to the 8630 study, in a way that you do need to know all the exact details of the hardware to implement your code without having the need to implement it on OS. Okay. I'm not sure if I made myself pretty clear, but the key thing is you need to understand how that architecture works. You can use Keil or you can use STM IDE. That does not matter. What you need to understand is, if you have the knowledge of ARM architecture, okay, let's just be very clear. By ARM architecture, I do not mean that you know how the ARM architecture looks. By ARM architecture, I want to know if you have worked on embedded C and run each and every code on that abstraction level on your ARM chip. Okay, if you have done that, then I don't think you'll have any problem with STM32. If you have not done that, I'd prefer you try embedded C once or assembly and just understand the architecture. User guide will be enough.
Okay, I think we should move forward. If you have any further queries, maybe you can contact Suresh after this meeting. Then you can have a proper discussion, then that would be better.
Proper discussion, as in I cannot help him much with embedded.
Yeah.
But I can give you an idea. I mean, as far as I've given already, but yeah.
Okay. Now I'll just cut short to this point over here. Opportunities in embedded. Okay. So, since we were discussing about PLSI and embedded. Okay. So, first of all, before you start to learn any software or anything, first you should know that you should have all your basics clear. Okay, I have seen many of my friends do this mistake that they learn softwares and they do projects and all those things. Okay, but when it comes to interview, okay, when you go into the interview, the person will first, they will start off with basics. They will not directly jump off to what you've done, your project or what high level things you have done. They will first start off with your basics. If you're not clear on your basics, you'll be chucked out then and there. Okay, so make sure whatever is there in your curriculum, you have your basics clear. Especially when it comes to digital analog, it's very important that you have all your basics clear. And you should know how the logic gates work. You should know that if you have multiple combinations, like if you rearrange your logic gates, what will be your output? Okay, so certain arrangements you have to see. Okay, so you should not miss out on the basics. You should be clear with your basics, then only you should move forward. Okay, so opportunities in embedded, when you come, we have certain roles in the industries. Okay, we have embedded systems engineer. So embedded, when we talk about, it comprises of both software and hardware. Okay, so whenever you get any requirement from any customer regarding any problem, okay, so first you have to come up with the solution that, okay, what kind of hardware you will use, okay, and accordingly what kind of software you will program into that. Okay, so like you have VLSI engineers, what we do is they fabricate a chip and they give it to us. Okay, embedded engineers, what we do is we pick up that chip and we design our solutions from those chips. Okay, so embedded systems, we should have a knowledge of both hardware and software. Okay, so we pick up the required hardwares and we decide, okay, what kind of software we need. Okay, then the software engineer, what he does is he writes down the program that has to be burned into that IC to run that lines of code. Okay, so whatever solution you have to implement that. Okay, then we have quality assurance engineer. Okay, so quality is one of the most important things that every company takes care that, okay, it's whatever goes out of the company, it should meet the quality standards. Okay, it should not be faulty, and if there is any fault, you should have the ability to correct that. Okay, so that is quality assurance. Project engineer. Okay, project engineer, I would explain it with an example from my case. Okay, so as I told you, I work in a Bosch, and I work in Bosch, and 60% of our revenue comes from the automotive industry. Okay, so when you talk about any car, you have various systems inbuilt in a car. Okay, you have your engines. You have your engine, combustion engine. Then you have your exhaust systems. You have your multimedia system. Okay, your stereo and car radio and all those things. Okay, so what a project engineer should have knowledge is, you should have a knowledge about the whole system. So when it comes to an automotive, okay, so you should have an overview about the car and how different systems work and how they're interconnected. Okay, so okay, now when I work in exhaust systems, okay, so I should know that at what speed and at what temperature my exhaust gases are released from the engine. Okay, at what temperature the combustion takes place. So once that information is available with me, then accordingly I design my exhaust system in order to reduce my emissions. Okay, so a project engineer should have an overview of the whole system, so that he can make sure that all the packages, all the teams working under him are working in sync, and the data that is being given to each package is correct, and it should be uniform. Okay, then okay, sales engineer, a normal thing. Okay, whatever products we design, the sales engineer takes care of the marketing and sales, like how should we pitch it to the customer analysis. Okay. So some what type of technology is there in the industry? Okay. Every company, every industry, they have their own certain kind of industry like ICs that we use. Okay. So it's specific to that we have only these kind of ICs that are used in industry. Every it's based on application. So like every application has different.
So mostly what you use in industry is STM, ARM. You don't use Arduino, you don't use Raspberry Pi, until unless you are just prototyping at the very first level. You use ARM, STM.
I've seen one question regarding this that someone had asked prototyping, that also wanted to know how prototyping is done in company related. Yeah. So okay. We do use, sometimes we use Arduino or Pi or something. But that is just for basic prototyping. Apart from that, what we do is we use our own ICs that we are giving to the customers. We use that and we program our ICs. We program it. We burn the program onto that ICs, and then we test it. Okay. So if you look, okay, I've reserved some a few domains. So when it comes to embedded domains, I have listed only four of them. There are many others. Okay, we can go on subclassification. Okay, but majorly we have this. Okay, we have mobile applications. Okay, so mobile whatever mobile products you're using. So majorly the company that takes care of this is, so one of them is Samsung, Sony. So they build the hardware and software, and then they combine it to deliver a phone bill. When it comes to medical equipments, we have Siemens, which is the leading company in this field, which they make the medical equipments. When it comes to automotive, we have NXP and Bosch, and there are other few. Okay, and consumer electronics. Okay, when talking about consumer electronics, I mean your television, your fridge, refrigerator, your microwave ovens. All those they consist of embedded systems, right? So if I take suppose the example of a microwave oven, okay, you select the programming mode, okay, like how much, at what temperature your microwave should work, and at what temp, at how much time it should work, okay. So all those things, again, you give in the input, okay, it should work for 10 minutes at 200 degrees centigrade, okay. So what it does is the embedded systems automatically turns on the heater and make sure that the heater stays at 200 degrees centigrade. And also it turns on the timer and it makes sure that the oven is running for 10 minutes. Okay. So that is how things happen. If you're looking forward for a career in the field of IoT, what things should be focusing on in general? Parth, I'm really sorry. I don't have any clue about IoT.
Okay, so. Yeah, okay. So we have a couple of questions.
What do you exactly mean by your question? Like
IoT one?
Okay.
If you
are IoT. Oh my God. I read IoT, that. Okay. Okay. Okay.
Okay. Field of lot.
Yeah, confusing.
Thanks. You should be focusing on the general. Okay. Okay. Sumita, you'll be covering this.
No, you cover this.
Okay. So basically, IoT is. Okay, so have you worked on Raspberry Pi, NodeMCU, I think, part? Have you worked on NodeMCU or IoT or anything like that? NodeMCU or Raspberry Pi or something?
Yes.
Yeah. Go ahead.
Okay, so has he replied? Yes, I have. Okay, so I think you do have a basic idea of what IoT looks like. This is sort of a definition. Basic definition is that everything that you do in embedded systems through hardwired connections, okay, all that data transmission and storage is now to be done over cloud or over your wireless transmission. Okay, so you do need to have a very strong understanding of data networks. I don't mean your circuit networks, how your computer networks work. Okay, what you studied in, what was the chapter? DNC, or what was the subject? We do have a subject now, Devanshu, in which we'll study about DCN. Yeah, sorry, DNC. Yeah, you do need to have a very good understanding of that subject, DCN. Apart from that, you do also need to have understanding of embedded, as you will be programming your end-to-end microcontrollers or whatever processing subsystem you're going to use, and you do need to have proper understanding of servers, how your web pages work, how your data is transmitted, how your data is stored locally or at your remote location. Okay, I don't know the exact details, as I have not worked on this IoT apart from a couple of 1-2 projects. From what I did, as far as I can tell, I did need proper information of what server I was going to use. We use Google Firebase, I think, to store the data at backend. So you do need to be familiar with all those concepts. Okay. Apart from that, I think if you want to do anything advanced, you should consult someone who is doing something advanced in this, which is not me.
Next question is, what type of compilers or softwares for burning writing codes do companies use, like Kube, Eclipse, or native compilers?
Okay, Devanshu, you gonna cover this?
No, you go ahead.
Okay, so as far as I know, this Eclipse or Keel, I don't think these are used in companies. Most companies do have their own proprietary compilers. Okay, or the softwares that they use. They don't rely on third-party compilers until unless the compiler is very good, or until unless it's like something like an established EDA tool. But we at this level do not have the information of all those compilers because those are proprietary and those are not available to the public. They're not even available for a course. Okay, those are the it's like every company has their own server. Okay, they don't rent out a server from someone else. Although they do use third-party companies to handle their server, okay, but they do have their own servers, right? Just like that, sometimes companies use their own compilers. Sometimes whatever compiler is popular, I think Keel is coffee popular, and Eclipse is coffee popular. Apart from that, I haven't heard anything else being used. But yeah, I hope that answers your questions.
And one more add-on to this is, okay, sometimes companies use the the ones that are popular. Apart from that, sometimes what we have is we have certain requirements. Every company has certain requirements. So what it does is they'll just search for compilers, okay, and then they will pick up. They'll come down to one compiler. And then they will ask that particular company which has made that compiler to just modify it for their own purpose. So that also takes place. So companies they will use their own. If companies can make their own compilers, they will do that. Otherwise, they will request the other companies to build a compiler for their specific.
See, this depends on the abstraction level you're working in. See, If you are just developing a first level prototype, then you'll probably be working on a microcontroller that is a very generic one. Okay, that will be available, like something from Texas or something from ARM, maybe even Raspberry Pi. Okay, people do work on Raspberry Pi and Beagle for their first level of prototypes. Okay, when you're just starting the scratching phase. Okay, so in that phase, you can use popular compilers, all those you mentioned, even some more that you have not mentioned. But when as deep you go into a development stage, more custom stuff do the companies start to build. I hope you get the point.
Okay, another question is, I want one suggestion, should we learn machine learning in on microcontroller like TensorFlow-Lite, or is it not required as an easy step?
That requirement depends on what you want to do, like after your graduation, you want to work.
Should we learn machine learning on microcontroller? See, there is no concept of machine learning on microcontroller. You cannot implement machine learning on microcontrollers that you have today. Okay. I mean, if we are talking about proper machine learning, okay, you need a huge data set, need loads of data to be processed at the same time. I don't think you can do that on Arduino, or I don't think you can do that on MSP430. Maybe Raspberry Pi. So that comes with Linux pre-installed, and that is pretty, I think, a solid piece of work. But apart from that, machine learning as of now cannot be implemented on microcontrollers. From what I'm understanding, your question is implementing machine learning on microcontrollers and not using microcontrollers to implement and enhance machine learning, because that will be a totally different concept. Okay, so you can use TensorFlow-Lite. Okay, you can learn whatever thing you want to get into machine learning. Again, that is something, that is a question for a person very particular to that field. Okay, but yeah, as far as you ask, machine learning on microcontrollers, there is no concept. I mean, I haven't seen or ever thought of implementing machine learning code, machine learning project on MSP430. I have not thought of that. Or any basic microcontroller. I haven't thought of that. If you can achieve that, kudos. I don't know if that can be done yet.
Okay. If anybody has any question, you could just speak.
Yeah, there was one question someone asked. Difference. Okay, this is, I think, IoT. One should have a grasp on networking like Zigbee, LoRa. See, XPO, LoRa, all those are Wi-Fi modules. Okay. So you can use NodeMCU, or you can use XP, or there was ESP. You can use all those modules. Those do not comprise exactly of IoT. Those also come as a part of embedded systems. But yeah, networks like TCP, IP, UDP, you do need to have a very good grasp on all those things. Yes. Yeah, there was another question. It was quite up the board. Jetson Nano is an NVIDIA board for machine learning. Nice. So Jetson Nano. Okay. See, that is what I'm talking about. Jetson Nano is not an ordinary microcontroller. That is a very specifically designed processor, or you can say subsystem, for implemented machine learning. So that cannot be called a microcontroller. By when you say microcontroller, the first question that comes to mind is Texas controllers, STM, or your ARM based controllers. Okay. So if you want to go into that, that is a separate field. Okay, there was one question, Dickel and Pearl. Okay, so yeah, if you want to go into VLSI industry, it is like major advantage to have the knowledge of Dickel and Pearl, or any scripting language for that sort. Okay, you can even use Python for scripting. Okay, the basic work that you'll be doing using Dickel and Pearl is, see, Dickel is basically used in your softwares. Let me share the screen.
Yeah, go ahead, please.
Yeah, see. So this you can see. I don't think you guys can see the screen, right? Okay, you guys can see the screen?
Oh yeah.
Yeah, okay. You see this thing right here? What does this say? This says Tickle console. So what Tickle is? Tickle is basically a scripting language. How that is used in VLSI, Tickle provides you an interface to interact with the tool. Okay, most VLSI tools support all the tickle commands that exist. Okay, see, you can say you can create tools that support Perl commands. You can create tools that support shell commands. Okay, your C shell commands or whatever, your Bash commands or whatever. But as the norm is as of now, it's a standard that 99.99% of VLSI tools that exist today, those tools support tickle commands. So those tools have inbuilt tickle consoles. You can use tickle script. See, in every tool, in every VLSI tool, you will have to enter a command to make the tool do something. Okay, if you want to run synthesis, you will have to enter the command. If you want to run elaboration or implementation of a design or simulation of a design, you will have to enter a command. Now you can do all those things through the UI. You can just click. But in industry, your designs are so big that your simulation goes on for hours. Okay, so you don't want to run simulation at 6 p.m. and then come back at 11 p.m. to office just to run the second part of simulation. That's because you had to click there on the UI. So what you do is you use commands like what you use in your Linux, your shell, okay, or like your Windows CMD. What you do is you use those commands, write a script using those commands so that they can be executed in one go, even if you're present or not. Okay, so what every VLSI tool supports is a tickle console. That means you can use tickle as a way to write scripts that can operate a series of steps, and you do not need to be present for the whole span of 16 hours just to click again and again on the screen. The tickle script will handle that whole thing for you. Okay, that is the basic idea. Just like this tickle console, each VLSI tool, almost every VLSI tool has a tickle console, supports tickle commands along with the inbuilt commands that it comes with. Each tool has its own set of inbuilt commands. But yeah, tickle is one language that they support, one common language that they support. Apart from tickle, Perl is also used, although Perl is not used in tools. But Perl is like a very strong scripting language. It provides you a blend of something like C++ and Python. Okay, you can use Perl is basically used for its regex expressions. You can just, I'm just gonna write it here. This is a very, very, very popular concept that is used in Perl. Okay, and that is used in VLSI on a daily basis. What do you do with this is, basically your work is to manipulate the data files that you get from these tools. One of the tasks that I have to do is, as a part of my job, what I do is, I get log files from my simulation. Like suppose I ran a simulation and I get a log file which is in GBs. Okay, that means a file that had, this is one script I made up. There was a file that had 11 crore lines. Text file that had 11 crore lines. Now, to organize, sort, and extract data from those 11 crore lines, I cannot do, there is no fucking possible way to do that manually, okay? So I will have to do that through script. Now, this is where Perl comes in, and this is where regex expression comes in. Now again, you can do the whole thing through shell scripting. You can do the whole thing through Python. You can do the whole thing through tickle. Okay, Perl is just a very common, easy to implement, a powerful, and what you can say, industry standard that is used. But any programming language would do. Okay. Any scripting language would do that supports regex expressions. So yeah, you should. In most cases, have a good idea about scripting. Let it be any language. If you cannot find resources about tickle, no issue. If you can't find enough resources for Perl, that's no issue. Learn Python, but learn it properly. And by scripting, I don't mean learn how to invoke libraries and use class functions directly. Okay, you should know how the code works on a deeper level. You should know algorithms, how hashing functions work, how sorting functions work, which algorithm does have a better time complexity, which algorithm, see, if I'm gonna run an algorithm on 11 crore lines, I want the see. This was something I did. I had to extract something from that same file of 11 crore lines. I wrote a program, basic program that extracted lines.
You will have to give precise answers. And as Sudha said, that if you're being asked about an X, just tell about X, not about Y or Z, and try to link it. So make sure you do not, you know, try to do.
Yeah, if you don't know the answer, just say it. There is no problem then accepting that you don't know about that topic. There is no harm.
See, let me tell you, this is the good thing about off-campus interviews. Everyone is very humble. At least the people I have interviewed with,
yeah,
even though I've been rejected a lot.
You're not trying to be super cool. They are humble.
Yeah, they are very humble. If you say you do not know something or you cannot think of an answer, they will help you with it. They will literally want to see how much effort you put in or how you think, even though you don't know a concept which you most definitely should know. They'll still ignore that fact for a moment and help you where to look for off-campus opportunities exactly in Harvard. Okay, we'll come that too. We'll come to that. We'll give you a list of companies, of course.
Okay. Once
Sumita
finishes her experience, then I'll tell you mine.
Sumita,
go ahead.
I'm speaking. Yeah, Sumita, okay, see. So those people are very humble and they will help you with it. Just don't give any answers that you are not sure about. Don't try to fill in the blanks or fill in empty spaces that you do in Bangalore. Just be honest. Think about it. If you see, I had an interview. I messed up a very basic question, which I had done 10 times already. I messed up a very basic question. Then I started panicking, like, what the hell was happening, man? I mean, I was supposed to have this on my tips. How can I not remember? How can I not think of it now? So I started flustering. And then that guy literally bought a glass of water for me, sat there for extra 2 hours till I completed my interview. Everyone's interview was in 15 minutes. I sat there for 2 hours, but he made sure that I think through every answer that I give. And I did that. And that interview was really good. I did not get selected because they still do judge you on the basis of your, what do you say, pressure handling skills, which I did not show very well. But still, that man sat through 2 hours, helped me get through the interview very well. I answered all the questions, like following the question I slipped. So the thing is, they're very humble. You should be honest with yourself first, then themselves. Don't try to think that I know this.
Exactly.
When you don't. Okay. And have a very strong grasp of what you are going into the interview with. If you are saying, I know a concept, you should know a concept very well. Don't say, I know this and have a basic idea about it. If you say, I know this, I have done this, you should know that thing in very detail. Okay, yeah, Dipanshu.
This, I got one question. I got this for 1 point in mind. Okay. So one very basic question every interviewer asks is, they will ask you, what is your favorite subject and your least favorite subject?
Yeah.
Okay. So, okay, favorite subject, you will probably say a subject that you are very confident of or you like very much. Okay. Do not say the name of the least favorite subject as the toughest subject or the one that you don't know at all. You should never do that. So that is one tip that I would like to give everyone, that you should never say that, okay, analog systems was a tough subject for me. So I didn't say that, you know, I don't like analog. I mean, it's not my favorite research, because what happens is they will ask you questions also from your least favorite subject.
Yes, they'll ask you why you don't like the subject, and to explain why you don't like the subject, you should have put a significant amount of time into studying the subject to come to the conclusion that you don't like it.
Exactly. In interview, they start with like very basic question. Like for me, the basic question was Ohm's law. That's what I was saying. And then as I'm from analog design engineer, so they need to check my RC knowledge.
Sumita, your voice is a bit. Yeah, not clear. A bit low.
My internet is not fine. Okay, I'll be a little louder from now. Okay.
Yeah.
So how my interview started is they first check my RC knowledge, low pass filters, high pass filters. They will just draw it, and you have to tell if that circuit will behave like a low pass filter or a high pass filter without writing a single equation. And how many poles will be there in the system? How many zeros will be there in the system? Like that. And then they went to transistors, like a very basic question, like how many regions are there in a BJT. So most of us think like in BJT, we have three regions, because only three books only teach us three regions, but there is reverse bias also. So we have four regions in BJT. So that we mostly skip, but I knew, so my interview, well, oh, you know that too. So that went well. Then he asked something related to frequency domain, like how Miller compensation and all those things work. But I think you guys are not familiar with those things. So I guess those things are in fourth year. So you will learn. So basically, they want to know the basics. If you know how a RC works, even if you end up giving the wrong answer, but your thought process was right, they will select you. They just want to know. They don't need the final correct answer. Most of the time, they even don't know the final answer. They will just give you random numbers and they will ask you to solve it.
They look at your approach.
Yeah,
yes.
They will look at your approach, how your thought process works. They just need to know that. That's it from my side, I guess.
There's a list of specific topics. Okay, let me give you a list of topics that you should know. Okay, let me share the screen first. I'll give you a list of topics that you should know. Okay, you guys can see now. My bad. Yeah. So.
Okay, so meanwhile, just prepare the list. Meanwhile, I'll just share my experience with it.
Yeah, okay, you share the experience.
Okay, I think we have third years over here till now. Maybe the third year, fourth year over here. Just yes, some of us. Anyone third year, fourth year?
I think they're all right.
Yes, me. Okay. Yeah, Ujjwal. Okay. Ujjwal Parth. Okay. So you guys must have heard about AMCAD. Am I right? AMCAD. AMCAD. From college itself, you must have heard about this. From the PNP. Yes, right? Yeah. Okay. So AMCAD, basically college, yes, given to. Okay. Yeah. So AMCAD, our college conducts this AMCAD exam. So what happens is basically we also gave that AMCAD exam, okay, and based on that AMCAD exam your profile is created. Okay, so you can go to your profile and you can check your whatever was your AMCAD score. Okay, and simultaneously you can fill in your details over there, like what is the kind of job you're interested in. Okay, so once you have that, okay, then companies will put out posts. Okay, we are hiring for certain posts and all those things. So similarly, we had Bosch which put out a post, and I got an email from AMCAD team saying that Bosch is hiring for this position and you have been listed based on your AMCAD score. Okay. After this, I was called for an interview in Lucknow, wherein I had a one-to-one interview, a technical interview first I had. So So in that, as you mentioned, right? Okay, you do not know the whole concept, but they will check your approach. Okay. So similar thing happened with me. I was given a question to design something using basic logic gates. Okay. So I was trying to implement that equation. Okay. And while implementing, I just got confused somewhere in between. And I somehow got caught in a trap, and I, you know, made that equation more complex. So I should have simplified it, but I just did a wrong step, and I made it complex. So just before that question, I had told the interviewer that, you know, I like to keep things simple, and I don't like to, you know, complicate much things. So at that moment, he interrupted and said that you have just told this, and you are just complicating your equation right now. So that time I did panic a little. Okay, then what he did is he suggested me a solution. Okay, you know, just try to implement the equation in this way. Okay, so that implementation I had not used it before, and I did not know about it. But okay, I tried to understand what he was telling me, and then whatever he told me, I tried to understand it, and I implemented what he was telling. So when I implemented that, and when I moved ahead, he stopped me before I could even complete my question, and he said that okay, I did not want you to, you know, I did not want the whole solution. I just wanted to see your approach, and I really liked it that you know, you followed my instructions and you understood what I was trying to say, and you implemented that. Because what happens is the company they are looking for people, you know, who can not only to people who have the skills, but also those people who have the ability to grasp a new skill and implement it. So you should be a quick learner also. So if you can, you know, because whichever company you go into, every company will, as a fresher, every company will give you a minimum of 1 month or 2 months training. Only after that, they will put you into projects. So after that, I had my technical interview. I cleared that, then I had a normal HR interview. And after 1 week, I got a mail that I've been selected. So that is my experience in this. And luckily, okay, I mean, many people, they have to go through many interviews to finally get selected into a company. But luckily, in my case, I just had to give one interview. So that's it from my side. Suyash.
Yeah, so
someone asked how to get good training, like cadence and
how. Yeah, we'll cover that too. Yeah, someone did ask that, I forgot, I'm sorry. Yeah, so here's the list of topics, at least from my experience, that you should know if you're going for an interview in the field of at least digital part of VLSI. Okay, analog requires you to know a lot more, than just this. But for digital, you need to have proper knowledge of all these topics. Digital electronics, you do not need to know digital electronics just on a basic level. You should know digital electronics properly, like how does an FSM work? Why does an FSM work the way it works? Okay, how to design FSMs, how to design them efficiently. Okay, all different types of timing issues. Static time analysis, you should know it very well. Okay, how clock skew works, standard timings, hold timings, data path analysis, clock path analysis, all that. You should know it very well. Okay, computer architecture. It will be a big advantage if you know this. Okay, they usually tend to ask you 8085 or 8086. Considering that you have studied 8085 or 8086, but if you have studied any other computer architecture apart from that, okay, you should just know that. Okay, so computer architecture in basics, C++, that is mandatory, like whether in digital, analog, embedded, all that, C++ is mandatory. Algorithms, you should be very good with. Okay, like what do you say, analytical thinking and qualitative analysis, you should be really good with. You should be able to formulate algorithms based on the problem set that you have been given very quickly. Scripting is, yeah, at least Python you should know, if not TCL and Perl. You should know data manipulation, okay, and how to work with file handling, at least Verilog. This is a must. If you are going to a digital site, Verilog is a must. You should know it in detail, how to write and convert FSM into Verilog code, how different types of different types of equations work, and I'm just forgetting the word. What is that? अरे यार सुमिता, दो तरह के शब्द क्या हो रही है? अरे दो तरह के वर्ड हो, अरे अरे एक नॉर्मल इक्वल टू होता है और एक इक्वल टू भी ध्यान होता है, क्या बोलते हैं उसको?
असाइनमेंट.
अरे यार असाइनमेंट, हाँ. ओके ओके, टू डिफरेंट टाइप्स ऑफ असाइनमेंट स्टेटमेंट्स, हाउ दैट वर्क, ओके, वेयर टू यूज व्हिच. दिस इज अ वेरी sequential and no, that is not sequential and conditional assignments, but yeah, assignments. There are two types of assignment statements in Verilog. So how they work in FSMs, in each construct you use different types of assignments. You should be very clear with where you use which type of assignment, okay? And yeah, if you do have some in-depth knowledge about tasks, functions and all that, that is good. If you have knowledge of system Verilog, that is a good extra advantage to have. Data structure, OOPs, that is also an extra advantage to have. Those are not the basic necessities, but yeah, basic VLSI flow you should know. Basic VLSI flow is what I covered today, the whole from specification design to the GDS to part. You should know all that parts. So those are the basics, topics that you should be really good with. Yeah, companies, someone was saying, yeah, do give them the idea of that.
Companies, okay, we have a huge list of companies, okay, and for off campus opportunities and good trainings, see, just be active on LinkedIn and keep looking out for opportunities on LinkedIn, okay. So get in touch with the people who have been working in the companies, just get in touch with them, and it's not just that, you know, you just send them a request, okay, connection request. You have to be active on LinkedIn and you have to do that. I think Sumita has been Sumita Swish, they have been very active on LinkedIn. So Sumita, if you could just tell how
I found one training when I was in when I completed my second year with Cadence. So so basically you have to write mails multiple times to HR, and it's quite based on luck. So my case, I think I was lucky maybe, but I did write like 50 or 60 mails to different companies, to so many people. So yeah, I know I'm crazy sometimes. So yeah, so in that
you have to be
that,
you have to be crazy, yeah, man. Yeah, you have to be crazy.
It requires. So I got calls from like 5 to 6 companies just after my second year. I didn't know what the VLSI meant, what the VLSI means in that time. So I got like 5-6 calls. Out of them, like Cadence was obviously the best opportunity, so I joined there, and I did just after second year I got a very good exposure that was very important for me at that time. So you have to approach HR, keep looking for that, and there is a fair chance that you won't end up getting in a very good company. So in Delhi we have LFT, that Logic Food Technology, right?
Yes, that is a very see Logic Food Technologies. It is hard to go in for training. You have to, but still, Logic Food Technology is still a growing company, a new company.
Yeah, it's a startup, but they
comparatively new, comparatively
good opportunity.
But yeah, it has opportunities. They work with specifically in digital design. On FPGAs, all type of prototyping work they do, they have products, and then embedded they are they have an ML or AI branch, I'm not quite sure. The good thing is you can contact their employees or their HRs through LinkedIn. All those people are like college pass outs, okay, like 2-3 years experience, okay, they will interact with you if you contact them. That is true for most companies, okay. So if you cannot get the HR to reply to your email, you can try to contact employees on LinkedIn, and don't just straight away go for like asking for a referral, like, sir, please refer me, I'm looking for this position. Like, so try to talk to them.
If you're trying to talk with an employee, then you should know what they are doing. Like, you can't go to a digital person and ask them for an analog profile, or you can't go to an analog person and ask them for a digital profile. So you should know that person a little bit, what they do, like that, and then approach them. It's better to, you know, personalize things. Like, you should know what they are working into, and then what generally to mention in such mails. Ujjwal, I guess you are in third year, so these winters you must be planning. So
in third year, in emails you do specifically write formal content. In messages through LinkedIn, which I would suggest you to do, you can start a conversation about anything. Like, see, if you want to get into some industry, try to be genuinely passionate or concerned about it. Okay, if you find someone who's working as a digital design engineer and they have made some projects in college, if you find their projects interesting, a good way to start the conversation is to ask them about the projects that they made. I have done it so many times. Not that each time the conversation led me to a referral. It happened very rarely. But yeah, at least I got to know something fruitful. They told me about what topics to cover. They told me about all those topics that I gave you. They told me about all the things that can be asked in an interview. Okay. So from every conversation, you cannot, even if you cannot get a referral back, at least you will get some piece of useful information back. And you, then that's one thing that you can at least count on, that contact in future, if you have started a conversation and built a small relationship with them. So that's how things work.
Yeah, first try to approach employees in, and one more tip, don't employ a person who is having 15 years of experience. He won't reply you. 15 years, and what will you even talk with a 15 years of experience person?
15 years, see, if you have more than 5 to 6 years of experience in VLSI industry, you are considered like significantly more experienced and profilic than people who are just at entry level, okay? Like, it's like, suppose you guys are going to be graduated, and you guys are trying to approach someone who has 10 years of experience or 20 years of experience. That person does not have sufficient amount of time to listen to your problems or like to even reply to you, because they get hundreds of similar texts every day. Okay. And 99% of people who text them start with the same thing, asking for referral. Can you refer me for this position? Hi, sir, I am this. They all write proper formal messages. There are very few people who ask them, not the people with 20 years experience, but at least people with 4 or 5 years of experience. There are very few people who ask them about their projects, who genuinely ask them about how they got this position, who genuinely ask them about what is their work in that position. Okay. They should know that you are interested in the work genuinely. Okay. It should not look that you're formally writing a message to ask for a referral. It should look that you want to be in a position that they are, so that they can relate.
Better write to people who are under like 5 years of experience.
Yes, write to people who are under 5 years of experience.
Yeah, and start your conversation with, you want to learn, not for referral. Nobody gets impressed by a referral, you know. So it's better you ask about the work, like how they learned, what things you should know, and how to enter industry. Later you go for referrals, and there's a fair chance that.
And before you know, contacting anyone, make sure that your LinkedIn profile is updated. And
exactly. Yeah. And please keep your profile photo. Don't keep that as a blank. I don't know why, but there are many people who keep their LinkedIn profile blank. And trust me, that makes a difference when you start, you know, having a conversation with anyone.
It makes a psychological difference. Yeah.
Yeah. Exactly.
Okay, apart from that, Electron asked, I'm currently in second year, what should I do to get training in Cadence? First of all, do you want to get training in Cadence? I mean, make your options very clear, because from as far as I can see, you were talking about you were talking about, yeah, that you working with that STM, na? So Cadence does not deal with any of that stuff. Okay, so if you are seriously interested in this field, then only you should get training in Cadence. If you are not yet clear about what field you should pursue, you should get more knowledge. Okay, from Electron to everyone, like analog design. Yeah, like analog design, digital design, EDA tools, most probably. They'll not directly get you into analog design, but they'll get you into ASIC design training. ASIC overview of EDA tools, okay?
Anyone, so, one more tip here. Anyone looking for analog design profiles, I would suggest you guys to go for masters first. I know. Okay, don't do that. Okay, I'm doing that just after my BTech, but I'm not here with a very good company. So if you want to end up with a like Texas or something, then you better go with, and anyway, this BTech knowledge is not enough.
Okay, we'll cover that topic. That is a whole different.
Yeah, that is. But he asked for analog design. So if you really want to end up in an analog profile, go for master's. Anyway, you will know by the end of your. Probably 6th or 7th semester, but just as a suggestion.
Yeah. So what I was saying is, if you want to get into Cadence, you can see on the website there is a option for training, like how to apply for training. They provide an HR email ID. Okay. Right now, I don't think you guys can apply, not only because of quarantine, but because applications start from January. So by the time you reach this April or May, all the applications have already been filled. Okay, they only take like what, 3 or 4 people. Okay, in like one city at least, in Noida campus, we had like what, in one department, we had 3-4 trainees only. So that is a very limited number of people. So yeah, you guys should, if you're gonna apply next year, you guys should start applying to Cadence or any other company. Most VLSI or embedded companies do have options for you to apply for training, or at least to contact the HR on their websites. That like do send them emails time to time. Okay, now like the way Sumita, as she told, in second year she somehow got an opportunity. She didn't somehow get an opportunity. She sent emails every week. Starting January, and then she got an opportunity in June. Okay, so that is definitely based on luck, but that is also something that you have to repeatedly do for them to notice you. Okay, so yeah, you can apply through their website, or the better way is to, if you want in Cadence, like contact HR through LinkedIn, probably get their email ID somehow, talk to someone. Okay. At least if you are able to establish a good conversation with someone, chances are they can share the HR's email ID. Just the HR's, not the HR personal email ID, but the company's HR email ID. Okay, and you can directly apply there instead of asking referrals from them. And constantly keep applying and take your chances and get a reply, hopefully. Okay. So yeah, based on luck sometimes, but you have to keep doing that. Apply all the places you can, all the ways you can.
Okay, someone asked me the contacts. Okay, I have shared Suyash, Sumita, and my LinkedIn profiles. So you can connect with us over there. And
alumni is first. No, it's better to start with. I'm saying better start with your alumni who are working in
correct, yeah.
Talk to the people who belong to your college and right now working in company you want to be, or like a related field.
Instead of stalking people on Facebook and Insta, stalk your alumni on LinkedIn. That's what Sumita has done. Okay. And all of us actually.
Yeah. So that's it. The companies, yeah, I'm going to give you a list of companies.
What we'll do is we'll share this list with IEEE mate, and maybe they can forward that because we have already gone over both the time.
Is there a WhatsApp group for this?
Anybody from the team, IEEE mate team?
Is there a WhatsApp group?
Roy, Ravi, I can see Sonalika.
General Secretary. Is there a WhatsApp group for the same?
Anybody from the team, please?
I am not a med student, can you? Yeah, I mean WhatsApp group as in not specifically for med students. WhatsApp group for the people who have attended
for this webinar. Don't have WhatsApp group for webinar.
Yeah.
Okay, yeah. Maybe we'll do one thing, Krish. Whatever information we have, we will just give these informations to the IEEE main team and they can forward them via mail.
All of you guys have registered through email, right?
Yeah, they are registered, yeah.
Yeah, so if you have registered through email, if your phone number is available, we'll try to make a WhatsApp email. If your phone number is not available, then we'll try to send all of you the whole list through mail. Okay, we'll try to segregate that company by company, field by field, like department and field by field. Okay, separate one for embedded, analog and digital. And
you guys can contact us on LinkedIn profiles now.
So. Yeah, you can contact us on LinkedIn. There's no issue. Okay, we have shared the profiles.
Okay.
I haven't registered, attended this webinar.
I've already accepted some requests on LinkedIn right now.
What's your real name, Electron?
Electron ka asli naam.
Electron ka asli naam kya hai?
I just received a request and I was waiting. I was going over the profile that who is this who's contacted me.
Parth Arora. Nice.
Okay, yes. Any other questions? Do you guys have any other questions?
No questions, but thanks a lot. Like this was really informative and helpful.
Oh.
Who's talking?
Okay, I would just like to answer this question, Rahul. It's not the certificate that matters, it's the skill that you possess.
See, this is a very, very, very basic question that everyone has. You do not need to have a lot of certificates or a lot of skills under your belt. What you need to do is have the basic skills that are required for the post and do go through them in very depth, as deep as you can. Okay.
Yeah.
And one thing,
just learn them. You know.
Yeah.
Very. मतलब बहुत अच्छे से सीखो यार. जो भी सीख रहे हो. चार चीजें आती हो तो वो चार चीजें अच्छे से आनी चाहिए. Instead of 10.
And I'll tell you, as a fresher, the company does not expect you to stand alone design a whole product for them.
Exactly, they don't.
Want you to have the basic knowledge. And as I said, you every company will invest you on your training. They will give you 1 month or 2 months of basic training. Okay, even today. Okay, it's been 8 months today. Okay, 8-9 months today. Still, I had 1 month of general training. Apart from that, in the last 7 months, every task that I have worked on, every time I have been learning and learning. Okay, and every time you learn something, you get a chance to implement it. So it's like that. So it's not, as I said, that the company doesn't want you to have an idea or the resources to just you join the company and you give them a product. No, it's not like that. So certificates, I think Rahul, it's clear, right? You need to have the skill. I mean, suppose, if you have a certificate in embedded systems, okay. Suppose you have a certificate in, machine learning, suppose. Okay, I'll just in general say, you have a certificate in machine learning, okay. You go for an interview, the interview sees, okay, Rahul has a certificate in machine learning. He asks you one basic question and you're not able to answer that. Your certificate is useless. Okay. On the other hand, if you have your resume and in that you have written, in under the skill section, you have written machine learning. And even if you do not have your certificate, okay, the interviewer will ask you a question on machine learning. And if you're able to answer that, the interview does not require a certificate. Okay. Well, yeah. Okay. Okay, apart from that, if anybody has any other questions, maybe you can contact us on LinkedIn, or I've shared all the three links. Okay. And yeah, that's it from our side.
Yeah,
email IDs also. I'll just write down my email ID. Maybe everyone else, Sumita and Suyash, maybe you can help. Like,
yeah, I'm gonna just write out my email ID.
Yeah, so these are our email IDs. Maybe you can contact us over here.
Okay, let me just give you the other one. Thanks for the session. Okay. So it's the first time Sandeep has said anything.
Sandeep has spoken, yeah, exactly what I was saying. Okay, I also had a great time in the session. Only one thing that I had told in the very first, the starting of this thing, that I wanted you all to, you know, speak up. Okay, we had the discussion over chat, but if you would have spoken up, then it would have been a better, you know, we'd have optimized our time.
It's anyway, it's if everyone's fine with it, watch.
Yeah, okay. Anything else?
Anything
from the
else
team or from the participants? If not, then we can close the session.
Okay, I think
we can. Ab to haan, ab kuch to bol de yaar. Come on, man.
अब तो खत्म हो रहा सेशन, अब तो बोल दो भाई, राम राम ही कर जाओ यार.
मैं बोल देती हूँ राम
राम. ओके, थैंक यू सो मच, थैंक यू सो मच, थैंक यू फॉर योर टाइम.
वाला
3 hours ऑन अ संडे. वाला मोगोलिस,
वाला मोगोलिस,
वाला दोहरिस.
See you guys.
Okay, thank you so much, guys.
Yeah. Hi, thank you so much.
Okay, so we shall end the meeting now.
Okay, no issue.